everyone. I'm Meghan Pinchuk, Chief Investment Officer at Morton Wealth, and I'm joined today by our CEO, Jeff Sarti. Today, we're going to be doing our market recap for the fourth quarter of 2022 with a little different format than usual. We're going to be looking back at 2022 performance and looking at the main drivers of that performance, and then also looking forward to 2023 and what our outlook is. So a lot happened in 2022. Let's go ahead and get right into it. I'm going to read a handful of headlines from the year. So, highest interest rates in 15 years are derailing the American dream. U.S. inflation hits four-decade high of 9.1%. 60-40 portfolios are facing worst returns in 100 years. Russia's invasion of Ukraine has roiled financial markets around the world. And get ready, a recession is coming. So, lots happening, lots in that, but we would really boil down the main drivers of asset class performance last year to two of those things, those being inflation and higher interest rates. And so maybe you want to start by unpacking the inflation side of it.
Yeah, so we've been talking about inflation, as you know, for a number of years now, and something we've been sharing with our clients on webinars. Again, going back several years, our concerns around the potential for inflation. And in many ways, we felt like a lone voice with regards to those concerns, especially with policymakers. They just felt very, again, flippant, sort of cavalier, not really concerned about potential inflationary pressures that we saw coming. And why is it important to talk about this and how we were thinking about it? I think it's important for clients to understand that we were prepared and thoughtful about this in advance. Very different from many in the industry where inflation caught them by surprise and now they're potentially reacting after the fact, which is potentially a little bit too late. With regards to inflation, when we think about the causes of it, there are a lot of causes, and we'll talk more about the various causes of inflation. But if we had to really boil it down to a few things, it really comes down to debt levels and monetary policies. When I say monetary policies, mainly talking about interest rates and money printing. Typically, when countries get into inflationary problems, it's related to those two things. So on debt, and you and I were looking at these numbers just a couple days ago, our federal debt back in 2008 was roughly $10 trillion. But then with the 2008 crisis and then COVID, we piled on more debts. And now it currently stands at $31 trillion. I mean, just a pretty remarkable number.
Yep.
So literally over 200 years, took us 200 years of our country's history to build up $10 trillion of debt. And then in just 15 short years, we tripled it. I mean, it's just very undisciplined fashion. And it feels like we're mortgaging our future in a lot of ways. Money printing, similar phenomenon. After 2008, we really went on a money printing tear and we printed $3 trillion. When I say we, Federal Reserve, who has the power of the printing press. So they grew their balance sheet from basically a trillion to $4 trillion over that time. And then COVID just launched it to the moon. They printed literally $2 trillion in just over 2 months, 63 days.
Yeah, that's the number that is just crazy to me, 63 days.
It's just an incredible number. And then they continued printing money throughout 2021. And so over the course of the last 15 years, they printed $8 trillion of new money. So just with that money printing, a lot of new money sloshing around in the system.
Yeah, and I think the idea of money printing is a little bit, you know, outside most people's, you know, not understanding, but core concepts that people are familiar with. And so the way we think of it a little bit is it's like when you're playing Monopoly is a fun example. When you've got your money and you have a limited amount and you go and Boardwalk comes up and okay, you're gonna pay your $400 for Boardwalk. If you dropped a bunch of cash onto the sky and everybody grabbed it, in my family, maybe there'd be some fighting. And and essentially you would be willing to pay more, right? If there was that much more cash around, you'd pay more than $400 for it. So it makes sense.
I love that analogy. It does remind me of my family when we were playing, not maybe as much fighting, a little bit more sneaky. I have a brother and sister, twin sister, and she used to be sneaky when she played. When she had a windfall, she would gather the money and hide little pieces of it and hide it under her stuffed animal. And then she would unleash it at unexpected times. And I mention that because you don't always know quite when the inflation's actually going to come. You think, oh, the money's there and then prices should rise immediately. Not necessarily. Sometimes there's a lag to this effect. And so related to that, a chart that we showed that we're going to show here, that we showed a few years ago on our webinar, is the unexpected nature of inflation. And when it comes, it could come in a very vicious and fast manner. So what this chart shows, it shows three different time frames. The first two columns are early 1900s, the second two in the middle, the 1940s after World War II. and then the last in the 1970s. And what you can see in the early part of each of those time frames, very low inflation, call it 1% to 2%. But then just 2 years later, really spiking to very high levels unexpectedly. So now let's take a look at what the last few years have looked like for us, actual inflation for us in recent years. So now on this chart, looking at the last 10 years, you could see that over the first handful of years, first 6 or 7 years, inflation was bouncing around at a low rate, roughly 0% to 2%. But then you could see what happened just a couple years ago, right around 2020 or 2021, where it really went vertical. And we went from roughly 0% or 1% to really 9% interest rates in basically a year or a year and a half.
You can see, too, the top of that was showing that even though now we reached this high in inflation, it has started to turn over and come back down again.
It is moderating, definitely.
And so I think our view on that is that it's certainly possible, given rising interest rates, which we're going to switch to in a moment, and what's happening with the slowing economy, that inflation could come back down this year or in the coming months.
Yeah.
And the question really becomes then, does it stay there? So how is it over and we just kind of move on with our lives? Or is there the potential for it to go back up again? And there's another interesting chart that looks back at the 1970s and a fairly similar pattern to this year where it was flat for a while, it spikes up, comes back down pretty meaningfully, and then spikes back up again. So I think the important takeaway is more that all of these inflationary pressures that you were talking about, they're not gone. They haven't gone anywhere. So even if it does come down now in response to interest rates, the question is going to be, will it stay there? And I don't think we can be complacent counting on that.
Yeah, we really don't know where it's going to go, but we do think there's going to be more volatility going forward.
Yeah.
But so now moving on, interest rates, the Federal Reserve had to combat this, had to combat these high inflationary pressures. So what have they done? They have started in 2022 to raise interest rates. So let's just revisit the chart that I just showed a couple minutes ago that shows inflation, and you could see over the last few years, look at when they started raising rates. And that's the circle we show here on the chart. It was actually just only 10 months ago, in March of 2022. And you could see inflation was already 8%. So they waited this long and the interest rates were still at 0% to finally start raising rates. They were late to the game. And so because they were so late to the game, they were somewhat backed into a corner. What did they have to do? They really had to put their foot on the gas and raise rates very quickly. So that's what this next chart shows. This shows various Fed rate hiking cycles going back to the mid-1980s. And you can see the steepness of this chart in 2022. The y-axis is the amount of interest rates in terms of percentages that they've raised. But on the x-axis, importantly, it shows the number of months. And you can see in just call it 10 or 11 short months, they've raised interest rates 4.5%, 5%, very quickly.
A big move.
It really is a big move. And so why were they so late to the game? If you remember, the Fed, when inflation started picking up in 2020, 2021, they kept using the word transitory, right?
Yeah.
Over and over again.
Yep.
That inflation would be transitory, meaning that they thought it would moderate very quickly. Well, they happened to be wrong, right? It had more staying power than they otherwise thought it would. But that's part of why they waited so long. And there were some rational reasons on why they thought it was transitory. A lot of the inflationary pressures were related to COVID. The world shut down, manufacturing facilities, factories around the globe. China had a ton of shutdowns. Really, China's only opening up of late. So finally, we do see some of those inflationary supply-related pressures moderating and rolling over. But still, from a high level, more big picture level, it really comes down to monetary policy and fiscal policy and debt. And we just see, we don't see an end to these debt-ridden policies, really trillion-dollar yearly deficits, we see them continuing in the future.
Yeah, I don't think that's going away. And so now the question is, of course, what is going to be the impact of rising rates on the economy? And the Fed's intention, to a large degree, is to slow the economy.
Definitely.
That's what they're trying to do. So you're starting to show signs of success. They'll be happy to see. And so you've got manufacturing that's weakening, retail sales that are weakening. Housing is starting to slow, and in a meaningful way, because housing was so strong for so long. We're now starting to see some real weakness there. And so now you're going to get the economy slowing, and the early indicator of that sometimes are asset prices.
Right.
And so to a large degree, 2022 was that leading indicator showing us when traditional asset classes really took big hits.
Yeah, so let's quickly have a quick review of how the asset classes, traditional asset classes, basically stocks and bonds, performed in 2022. So we'll pull up this chart here. And what this shows is basically that pretty much all traditional asset classes, now we're not talking about alternative asset classes, we're going to get into that later, but traditional stocks and bonds, there was nowhere to hide. Everything was down this year. Starting with the first column, that's large cap US company stocks. It's basically the S&P 500, down 18%. Second column, smaller US stocks, more domestic focused companies, down a similar 20%. But then let's say you want to diversify internationally. In a broad-based international markets, down 14%. That developed market column, that's basically Europe and Japan. Emerging markets, so that's Asia and South America, maybe parts of Eastern Europe, down close to 20%. I mean, just again, nowhere to hide. But the really shocking statistic on this page is bonds. Bonds, the far right column, down 13%. By far the worst year in the history of this index. So this index goes back to the 1970s. So just incredibly poor performance from bonds. And typically bonds are supposed to be the resilient safety net part of your portfolio. And when stocks go down, typically there's a flight to safety and bonds hold up, right? They're the protection in your portfolio. Just not the case this year. We show one more column here, which is just short-term bonds. And you can see down much less than the broad-based index, down about 4% or so. And the point of that is in bondland, there were still some places that were more resilient than the index. In essence, if you took on different types of risk, shorter maturity bonds, which we did at Morton Wealth. So, and we're going to get into that a little bit later, how our bonds did hold up a bit better than bonds at large. But big picture, it was a tough year for traditional assets. That being said, we obviously had a lot of exposure to alternative assets, and we're going to get to that later in this discussion. And our alternative assets really held up very nicely in a challenging year.
Let's start though, let's go into stocks and bonds a little bit more, and then we will transition to the alternative. So starting with stocks, I think the inflation and interest rates being the things that are really moved those downward, it might not be that intuitive why inflation is bad for stocks. Right. So it is the case, and you look back at periods of inflation like the 1970s, but why does inflation hurt stock performance? And if you think about a company that maybe even makes widgets, the cost of those widgets go up, right? So now their costs increase. And then the question is, can they pass through those costs to their end consumers? Can they raise their prices? And we saw that last year, right? I guess that's where inflation came in, where prices went up. If the Fed is successful at causing a recession, essentially, or slowing the economy meaningfully, demand's going to go down, right? People lose jobs. They don't have as much money. They won't be able to pay as much or be willing to pay as much for that. And then that's where companies could really get crunched on the inflation side.
Yeah, inflation is a tricky and challenging aspect that companies have to face. That's why stock prices have been hurt to some degree. But then also rising interest rates. Right. Rising interest rates are really a headwind for stocks. So why is that? Why is that the case? And I'll give a hypothetical example. So we all know that interest rates have risen, call it about 4% this year. Let's just make an exaggerated example. Let's assume instead of interest rates having risen 4%, let's assume they went up 20%. They actually went up close to that in the early 1980s, high teens.
Let's not hope for that.
I know, let's not hope for it. But so in that new world, now you can buy a US government bond, a risk-free bond, and make 20% a year. All of a sudden, that's a pretty attractive investment. Now, let's say you still like this high-growth tech company, a stock. And you think maybe it will double or triple in a 5 or 10 year period, and you might want to buy that. But all of a sudden, now you have this alternative. You have this alternative investment in a bond where you can make a guaranteed 20% per year. Which one are you going to choose? And I think it's probably pretty clear. It's pretty clear that you're probably going to lean more to the bond side of the equation in that example, and then you'll probably sell your stocks and buy more bonds.
Right.
That's why rising interest rates put pressure on stocks, specifically growth stocks, where you're speculating on some future growth. Now, what have we had in the last decade? We've had the exact opposite. We've had literally 0% interest rates, all-time low in interest rates. 0% interest rates create very perverse incentives because now most investors, non-Morton investors, they only have two choices, stocks and bonds. And all of a sudden, their bonds in a 0% interest rate environment, it's really not a choice. So then you're forced to speculate on stocks and make a bet on future growth. The future becomes more interesting than the present in a zero interest rate environment. So a couple years ago, we expressed again, a lot of concerns around this in a webinar, in many webinars, but I'm gonna pull up one chart just to revisit how some of the stocks that we highlighted, how they've done in this rising interest rate environment. So this chart shows four stocks. Many of you are familiar with the two in the middle, DoorDash and Airbnb. The one on the right, a company by the name of Snowflake, big company in cloud computing and software. And then the company on the left, QuantumScape. You could see the valuations that these were trading at. Snowflake was trading at 200 times sales, literally sales, not even earnings, yeah. But 200 times its revenue. QuantumScape, it is a battery maker for electric vehicles, but pre-revenue, it was still in the development stage, hadn't actually even sold a battery yet, but its valuation, it was worth $50 billion. Just an incredible number. Twice the valuation of Panasonic. Panasonic's the battery maker for Teslas. So how do these companies do since they're high? And here you can see the numbers here. I mean, they've just, gotten decimated.
Yeah, got crushed.
Most extreme example, QuantumScape down 94%. So literally, if you invested a dollar in QuantumScape, you now have six cents in your pocket. A few names that people recognize a little bit more, Tesla down 68%. Facebook, now Meta, they've definitely had some mishaps in terms of their strategy, but still down two-thirds, down 65%. And finally, Zoom is an example, a company we use on a daily basis, down 88%. So nowhere really to hide with these growth stocks.
And like some of those stocks they named, just they're good companies.
Yeah.
And the question that we're getting from some clients is that the time to buy? Because
right.
They see the previous high it reached and where it is now, and if it goes back to that previous high, that would be a pretty good return. I think the thing to be aware of or watchful of, though, is anchoring to that previous high and thinking to yourself, okay, that's where it's going back to. Because who knows if we're going to go back to a zero interest rate environment regime, but that really was the driver of it, right? Not the company so much as interest rates being so low, people willing to speculate to that degree. So I wouldn't get anchored to, oh, great, this is where it's heading back to. A good real life example of that was Intel. So in the late 90s, you know, everyone knows what happened with the tech bubble and prices going crazy, similar kind of speculative fervor. Intel got to a crazy level. It crashed down to earth with the bursting of the tech bubble. And then still today, years later, it is trading at about half of where it was at its peak back then. And it's a great company. You know, it's the revenue's grown, the earnings have grown. It's just not, it can't get back to that crazy level. That wasn't a realistic number back then.
Yeah, when valuations become untethered and aren't tied to fundamentals, I mean, to your point, it's hard to figure out when they'll ever come back to those types of levels again.
So turning to our stocks, how did our stocks do last year? And we have had, so we do have broad-based stock exposure, and it certainly weren't immune from what was happening in markets. But we did have more of a value tilt that for some years now actually has not been as ideal, right? Growth stocks were the place to be, but tilted more toward quality companies, companies that actually have earnings, and they pay dividends. And so that tilt was helpful last year in terms of outperforming if you were more overweight to those growth stocks. And then looking forward, I think similar to the phenomenon you discussed about interest rates and growth, if interest rates keep going up, growth stocks are going to be vulnerable to that due to continued corrections. And the reverse could be true as well. If we ended up seeing a situation where interest rates did come back down, then maybe growth stocks do well in that type of environment. I just don't think it's something we're willing to bet on. There's still so much uncertainty out there related to what's going to happen with rates and the economy and inflation that we're fairly happy with where our stock targets are at this point. So we have, we're at a fairly low level, you know, relative to ourselves, at least historically. And we've been happy with that level, especially with some of the alternatives we're going to get into as being the substitutes for that. But we're holding where we are. Some clients who might be maybe underweight to their specific targets, we might strategically add a little bit to stocks around the margins. But generally speaking, don't feel like this is a time to jump all in.
Yeah, couldn't agree more. All right, should we talk about bonds now?
Let's do it.
All right, bonds, really interesting year, volatile year. As we mentioned before, toughest year in history. The index was down 13%. Another example, let's just assume you wanted to buy a risk-free, and I'm putting it in quotes, risk-free U.S. Treasury bond. 10-year U.S. Treasury bond at the start of the year yielded 1.5% per year. Interest rates rose, now currently yielding in the mid-threes. With that interest rate move, though, bond prices go down, and that bond's literally down 18% in the year. Just an incredible destruction of value. So literally, if you own that bond, you would have lost over 10 years worth of yield in 1 year based on that bond price move. So quick reminder, primer on how the math works, why rising interest rates hurt the price of bonds. Simple hypothetical example. Let's assume in the beginning of the year you wanted to buy a Microsoft bond. Make a loan to Microsoft, let's say it was a 3% loan. So you lend them $1,000, you make $30 a year, and let's assume it was a 10-year loan. So now, fast forward a year, interest rates have risen to, let's say, in the 5 to 6% range, and now a new buyer of Microsoft bonds can literally earn twice the interest rate that you own in that legacy bond that you've held for a year. You're not a happy camper because that's a contract you have with Microsoft. That's a fixed rate, and you are stuck making that $30 a year, even though interest rates have risen for the next 10 years. I mean, there's really nowhere to go. So what has to happen? That bond price has to go down. And that's what's happened across bond land. So that being said, our bonds, well, generally speaking, on the traditional side, our bonds are down. Our alternatives that we'll get to, they were generally up. But our bonds, while our traditional bonds were down, they were typically down less, and in many cases, much less than the bond index. Mm-hmm. And why is that? It's for two main reasons. First is maturity. We talked about this, like the Microsoft example, a 10-year bond. Our bonds typically have much shorter maturities, typically 3 years on average. So yes, while that's still a three-year contract, you're not stuck forever. In 3 years, hopefully that money will come back to you when the loan matures, and then you could reinvest at a higher rate.
Right.
But then also, a large percentage of our bonds are floating rate in nature, meaning that you're not stuck in a contract with a fixed rate, but as interest rates rise, many of our bonds have actually increased their yield over the course of the year, which has been helpful for our bonds.
Yeah. There are a lot of traditional managers now who are talking about their performance last year in bonds. Mm-hmm. And again, they touted bonds as the safety net in their portfolio for clients. And they had longer duration, and they had more interest rate sensitivity in the portfolio. So they took some of these hits, you know, that we're seeing in the index.
Mm-hmm.
It's frustrating because that concept of like, oh, well, you really didn't know it was coming. I guess if you were just doing rearview mirror investing and saying, well, look, for the past 30 plus years, this is what's happened in bonds, that would have been somewhat fair. But it was just so obvious, right? Your example of how little you were making and how much risk there was in the system. And the risk was just math, right? Interest rates rise by this, you know what a bond's gonna drop. So it's just a little inane, the idea that they would just ignore that risk.
Yeah.
That was just risk reward throughout the window. And it was just saying, hey, this is what everyone else is doing.
So. I agree. I mean, somewhat intellectually lazy on the part of many bond investors. I agree.
So now, though, I guess the good news to this whole scenario is that for the first time in a long time, bonds are actually pretty exciting.
I can't remember the last time we said that. It really
I don't
was
think actually in my career. but so it's something where we're looking at opportunities out there. We made some changes last year to bond managers. We added a couple of new managers that mm-hmm. we were excited about. And just to give you an idea, we're still able now, you can keep things fairly short term, still not take on a lot of interest rate risk, but actually make some pretty compelling returns. Mm-hmm. One of our new managers made a loan to a company that was in advertising. There's really good cash flow. The company actually has some good assets. And this loan was only 2.5 years. And it was a senior loan in the capital structure, meaning that when things got paid back, this loan would get paid back mm-hmm. first. So for 2.5 years, you're getting paid about an 8.5% yield per year. So pretty compelling. Again, not just the return itself, but then that structure up, but the fact that it's short term, the fact that there's assets, it's actually a pretty attractive investment. And so going forward, we're excited about this asset class.
Yeah, definitely the dynamics have changed and bonds have become much more attractive than they were.
Yeah.
So obviously we just covered traditional bonds, but a lot of the way we generate income from our clients are in the alternative world, private lending.
Yes.
Private lending's been a big substitute for us with regards to traditional bonds. And backing up a little bit, why are we so passionate about private lending in clients' portfolio, going back now over a decade, really starting really in 2010, revisiting a discussion you and I had back in October at the Investor Symposium, where I use the analogy of when we think about building, crafting an investment portfolio, we think of it kind of like building a football team. Most investors only have two positions, stocks and bonds. But when we think about building a football team, you need a lot of different players with a lot of different skill sets and purposes in the portfolio. And we do that across our various alternative assets. Now, specifically narrowing down on bonds, when I think about bonds, I think of them as the offensive linemen in the portfolio, you know, those rock solid, resilient 350-pound linemen that can't be budged. They're sort of the core part of your team or your portfolio. The problem is, as we were evaluating bond managers and interest rates over the last decade, as interest rates started coming down further and further and further, that 350-pound lineman looked like a 250-pound lineman and also a scrawny 150-pound lineman that we just knew was going to get bulldozed over once interest rates rose. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what happened. So what did we do? Well, in advance, we started trimming and really firing these offensive linemen, these bond managers, in favor of these private lenders. And they've just been wonderful for us, not just for the last decade, but really most importantly in 2022, where they continue to earn their high single digits, even in a world where bonds were down and down a good amount. So by way of reminder, what are these private lenders? These private loans are typically making loans on assets. Often it's on real estate or to corporations. It could be on things like inventory or equipment. All right, so it's things that you can really touch and feel and grab. Also, why have these done so well? It's related to this duration or maturity argument that you just hit on with that one bond example. For instance, with real estate, our typical loan is 12 months, very short term in nature. So yes, importantly, we're earning a high yield for those 12 months, but then also you're not locked in. So as interest rates rise, the loans mature, we get our money back within 12 months, and then the managers are able to potentially charge higher rates to the next borrower. And we are seeing that with some of our private lending managers that they do have pricing power and are starting to charge higher rates.
Yeah, definitely. And so they did great last year. Mm-hmm. 2022 was a really stellar part of the portfolio. It's a fair question too to say now, going into 2023, will that continue? And so specifically, if there's a recession, if the economy gets rocky, and I think in a normal recessionary environment, whatever that means, but in something where there's a mild recession or even a tough recession, we think this asset class is going to have a lot of resiliency to it. It is something where not only are these loans short-term, but the nature of the loans is they're making pretty conservative amounts that they're advancing against these assets. Right. So specifically, if you had, let's say, a $10 million property, they might only lend $6 million against it, whereas a bank might do $8 or $9 million even. So there's a big cushion before the value of these loans would get threatened. You'd have to see a major drop in real estate prices before you'd have risk to your principal. Now, realistically, that doesn't mean that there won't be issues. I think if there's a recession, what we would expect to see would be maybe cash flows potentially getting interrupted. If there was a really nasty environment, they had to go foreclose on properties, go get those assets, essentially. You could see cash flow interruptions, liquidity, maybe investors can't get out as frequently. Right now, it's very liquid. People can get out quarterly with really no issues. So maybe liquidity dries up a little bit. That feels like a good alternative risk to saying market risk. Because in that environment, I'll tell you, traditional assets, stocks and bonds, that is not going to be a pretty situation. So in this case now, if you can trade a little bit of liquidity risk for that market risk, we think that's really smart in a broader portfolio.
Yeah, totally.
So recapping in with fixed income, we are excited about private lending going forward. We are excited about traditional bonds, or the traditional bonds, much more so than we have been in a very long time. And thinking through even that, we have some alternatives in the liquid space too, things like SPACs, special purpose acquisition companies, that really we're treating more as short-term treasury type substitutes. And even those last year, as an example, they held up really well. They were anywhere from flat to up small. Right. And so can you find things that are going to behave differently and that are going to hold up well in all kinds of environments? That continues to be our focus.
Yeah. All right. So now let's transition to another couple of types of alternatives in our portfolios. Great. Gold. Gold's been a core part of our portfolios now going back a number of years. And to revisit the purpose of gold in our portfolios, it's a few things. One is gold really is a diversifier. It just behaves differently than anything else in your portfolio. Secondly, over the long term, gold has proven to be a hedge against inflation, a true store of value. And then lastly, most individuals, the lion's share of their net worth is held in US dollars. So to have an asset, in essence, a currency alternative that is distinctly not a US dollar, we think that makes sense as a hedge and insurance policy against your dollar exposure. So all that being said, how did gold do? Gold was flat, down about 1/3% in 2022. And it's a reasonable question to ask, why didn't gold do better in an inflationary environment like 2022? So I'll hit on a couple things. First of all, performance. It was flat, not bad.
Yeah.
Really held its value to some degree, especially compared to other liquid traditional assets.
Right, you would have rather owned gold than stocks and bonds.
Exactly. The more theoretically you had in gold, the better with regards to a traditional portfolio. But also, we shouldn't just look at the last year, because inflation has really been picking up for the last 2 or 3 years. So if you look at when inflation started in early 2020, the price of gold was roughly $1,500. So it's risen roughly $400 over the last three-ish year period. So it's really actually held up nicely as compared to inflation. All that being said, still flattish over the course of 2022. So why didn't it do better? Starting with the dollar. So the dollar was up 8%, very strong in 2022. That's really unusual in an inflationary environment. Typically, when a country has inflation, the currency associated with that inflation, the dollar in this case, typically goes down in value, depreciates. That was not the case. And now gold is priced in dollars. So if a dollar is stronger and has more purchasing power, theoretically, the price of gold should have gone down. But again, it was flat and in essence held its own. So that's the first thing. The second thing is rising interest rates. So rates have risen a good amount this year. And similar to the discussion we had around stocks, if you're looking at a stock and investing with the hope that that stock will appreciate at some time in the future, but now all of a sudden interest rates have risen and you have an alternative, a bond alternative, that's a certainty in terms of return in the here and now, you might now not be as inclined to buy that stock and you might be more focused on that bond.
Right.
The same is true with gold. Gold is really an investment with a hope that it will appreciate in price in the future, not right here in the here and now.
No current income.
No current income, exactly. So if you have higher current income with bonds, I mean, there's a trade-off now that's become more attractive with bonds. All that being said, what is our outlook for gold going forward? We're as passionate about gold being a core component of the portfolio as ever. It's for a few reasons. One is if inflation stays somewhat sticky and elevated, that can be good for gold. Secondly, the dollar. If the dollar kind of levels out or even goes down from here, that could be very good for gold. And just quick data point on that, even though the dollar had a strong year last year, in the fourth quarter, the dollar was down 7% and gold rallied 10% just in the fourth quarter. Mm-hmm. So you could see that inverse sort of correlation between the two. And finally, interest rates. Interest rates have risen a lot. Most don't believe, and we don't really either, that interest rates probably are going to go much higher from here in terms of the Federal Reserve and what they're going to do. So if interest rates kind of flatten or even go down, that can be a meaningful...
That could be good for gold.
Exactly, right. Exactly.
All right, so the last asset class we're going to cover is real estate equity. We covered the real estate private lending loans, and this is now actual ownership of the properties. And the publicly traded real estate market last year had a fairly tough year. So REITs, real estate investment trusts that are like publicly traded stocks to some degree, they were down about 25%. Mm-hmm. And so we really don't have a lot of exposure to that. Where we have more of our exposure is on the private real estate side. Typically, you're in a private partnership. There's qualifications. Investors have to have a certain net worth to invest. And so in that case, our real estate so far has been holding up very well. And there's three reasons for that. Real estate is sensitive typically to rising interest rates. That's bad for real estate. The simplest reason just being that the cost to borrow went up. And so any other investor out there who's looking to buy that asset is going to have to borrow at a much higher rate. And that should, in theory, drive the price down. So that piece is bad for real estate generally. But the other component that is a major driver of real estate pricing is income.
Mm-hmm.
So income was up meaningfully last year because of inflation. Almost across all types of real estate investments, income was up meaningfully, and most of our managers, we're about to do our year-end valuations, but most of our managers are saying that they feel like the rising income from some of this is offsetting that negative impact from rising rates. So we'll see where the numbers shake out, but importantly, we tend to favor managers who like fixed rate debt. So they've been concerned for years with interest rates potentially rising, even though it took a long time to get here. The flip side is we've got managers who for years and years have been warning of this as well, similar to us. And because of that, they fixed their debt whenever they could.
And that was even a little costlier for them, right? I mean, they could have
absolutely
been cued and got floating rate debt at cheaper rates, but we were very supportive of them locking in that fixed rate debt so they weren't exposed to these rising interest rates.
Yes, and it was no coincidence that
right.
We picked managers who had those biases.
Right.
But they locked in their rates when they could. And so in that specific example, if you had a property where you had fixed rate debt, so now you have these very low cost of debt, but now your income was up meaningfully, that actually could be very positive
mm-hmm.
for real estate valuations in that case. So we'll see how it shakes out for last year. I think going forward, importantly, we are on the lookout now for opportunities. So the other managers out there who did get cute with floating rate debt or who maybe borrowed too much on properties, they stretched a little bit much because debt was so cheap, they're going to potentially have a crunch situation if interest rates stay high. So if interest rates stay up, their costs, their borrowing costs are going up. Maybe they'll have trouble refinancing properties as that comes due in the next couple of years. And that could present opportunities for longer-term investors who are looking for an interesting entry point. Mm-hmm. And so we're excited about KCB Management, which is a real estate partner that we've been invested with since 2003. We've been in all of their partnerships over the years. And I think KCB is ideally situated to deal with this exact situation, which is one of uncertainty, right? Nice. So will there be great, amazing opportunities? Maybe, maybe not, right? Maybe things change, maybe rates come back down and that shifts the dynamics. If there are opportunities, I think KCB will do a good job picking up, you know, finding those opportunities, getting them into the portfolio. And if not, they've proven themselves in the past to be really patient. So they will wait. If they don't find the right opportunities, they're willing to not deploy capital. They have large amounts. The manager has a large amount of their own money in the fund, so they're very aligned with investors. And if it doesn't make sense to deploy, they won't. So I think that's it's a great way to be ready to jump on this opportunity if it really comes.
Yeah, it's amazing that we've been partnering with them for 20 years. I mean, KCB has really just been an incredible partner for us. So in conclusion, we're really proud with how our portfolios have held up in a very challenging year, 2022. You talked about stocks. Stocks obviously had a tough year. And our stocks were not immune. They were down, but again, based on our positioning, down typically less than the stock index. Bonds, similarly, bonds had, again, their worst year ever in traditional bond land. But our bonds were, again, typically down, and in many cases, much less than the bond index based on our positioning. But more importantly, we just had much less in the way of those two assets than most traditional managers, because we have exposure to so many different things in the alternative investment universe. And those things really, they held their own. They performed as well as they had done in previous years. So really created a lot of resilience for our portfolio. Now looking forward, we hit a lot on this, bonds. Bonds are, for the first time in a very long time, creating compelling opportunities. Again, these are not, it's not swing for the fences, home run type of opportunities, but at the very least, in a lot of areas of bond land, we feel we're being adequately paid for the risk we're taking. And then finally, what is our focus going forward? It continues to be vigilant, focusing on non-traditional diversifying assets away from stocks and bonds. There's just so many uncertainties. We still don't know what the path of inflation looks like, interest rates, a potential recession. So as much as we can to continue to incorporate assets that are just going to behave differently in the portfolio and be resilient, I mean, it's just, it's something we're passionate about and we're going to continue looking for those. So all that being said, I hope you really enjoyed this webinar. And thanks so much for watching this market review. Hopefully you found it enjoyable and educational. Be on the lookout. We're going to be hosting a live Q&A session on Zoom on February 7th. So we can answer any questions you have around your investments, your portfolio, or the economy at large. So thanks very much.
Thank you.